Okay, we are recording. Welcome everybody to today's session. I'm pleased to welcome Stefano Tempesta back to join us for today's event, all about integration design patterns. So Stefano, let me hand it off to you.
Thanks, Jason. Much appreciated. Good morning or good afternoon, everybody. So our session today about integration design patterns, and we'll focus on some strategies for integrating data in Dynamics 365 solutions. I want to approach this in two phases, or actually three. One is, let's set the ground for everybody to understand what these integration design patterns are. What is a design pattern specifically, and what are the common ones that we want to use for data migration and integration. These are very generic patterns, so not just specific to a CRM solution. As we will see in the second part of this session, will be more contextualized to Dynamics 365 solution, using a combination of a concept, a model of the Enterprise Service Bus, an ESB, or a slightly new approach that Microsoft is suggesting for data integration based on Power Apps. So this is the agenda for today. And before we just go into it, let me just quickly introduce myself. So I said my name is Stefano Tempesta. I'm based in Zurich in Switzerland. I'm Microsoft MVP and chapter leader of CRM UG for Italy and Switzerland. My social coordinates are on screen. Whoever wants to get in touch after this session, please feel free to do so. And that's all about it, pretty much. So let's get started with an overview of some common design patterns for data integration. Now, I selected these five that you see on screen because of some of the most common that I've been using for some time. And I'll go through all of them now and briefly in presenting the benefits and applications when to use one of the other one. So for example, the migration pattern. Well, here is very typical situation where we want to migrate some large volume of information from any system to our Dynamics 365 solution. It's typically a one-way data flow where we have something in input that can be in the format of a CSV file or a database access or any data sources, and then we want to import into our target solution. It's typically also a one-off execution for each source, and we will process all the records in batch. Do I have a comment that some people cannot see the screen? Let me see one second.
I am seeing your screen.
You can see your screen.
Stefano, whatever that's worth. And okay. Other people are saying they can see it as well.
Okay.
If anyone else is having an issue, please do send us a chat and let us know.
Okay. Okay, I'll carry on for now if we have another issue.
I'll work with folks in the background if anyone else has an issue.
Cool, thanks. All right, and so I'm saying this is typical migration pattern where we process batch of information as multiple records, one-off, and is typically lands into our this 365 solution by setting basically a data format that has been accepted, has been agreed between the two systems. As we move also into the evolution of integration patterns, we'll see how a point-to-point integration also has some limitations. Limitation in the fact that, first of all, we need to agree on the format in input and the format in output and do some form of mapping between the two, so that whatever comes as a source data respect rules and format of the destination. And there is also a limitation in terms of availability or guarantee of delivery of the message. What if your target destination is not available for any reason? What happened to the message? Is it lost? Is it reprocessed? So this is the mechanism of queuing messages, records, that has to be implemented as part of the solution. And there is a third component of security in some way. So access to the source data should be secured, should be authenticated, as well as access to the target. And the channels, the communication channel, should be secured in a way that there is no possibility for third party to tamper with information that is in transit. All these challenges will be addressed by implementing an enterprise service bus, as we will see in a moment. But let's carry on all, still with the overview of some common integration patterns. So we have a bit of a common understanding also on the additional challenges that are presented by having integrations among different systems and how we can resolve them. The broadcast pattern. Now we want to extract information out of Dynamics 365 solution and broadcast, so ship this information to different systems. So it can be an ERP system, a payroll, any application in our portfolio or IT systems that will need to access information that are stored centrally in our CRM. For example, if we assume that our CRM is the master data source, then some information that we display on a website, for example, will be accessed through the Dynamics 365 API, typically in real time and displayed on the web. Now, typical challenges here, again, performance. We don't want to hit the Dynamics 365 backend with potentially thousands of concurrent requests, especially if it is a public website. We are offering a service to the public, and we have citizens in our borough that are connecting to the government public website, and we potentially have millions of transactions, thousands of concurrent sessions. They all go and call this API. What is the mechanism for improving performance? It will be based very likely on caching this information. And then there is a requirement for invalidating the cache when a change occurs on the backend, on the CRM side, and refresh information in the cache so that it is visible in the website. So let's see also how this can be addressed in a context where we're using the enterprise service bus. Aggregation pattern. Now, this is the reverse of the situation before. We have different systems that are talking to our Dynamics 365, so many to one, and merge this information into the single view of our customer, of our piece of information in general. Now, this can happen in real time, but most of the time, from my experience, I've seen this happening more on a batch schedule execution. The reason is that although real time is always a preferred option, where you know some information that enter into the website are immediately reflected on our Dynamics 365 backend, most of the cases we will have a requirement for merging this information based on some form of natural key. What is a unique identifier of our customer in the ERP system and in a payroll system or in HR system may not necessarily be a common unique ID that we will have a unique record also in the CRM system, for example. So that means that we need to implement some form of resolution, avoiding duplicate and consolidating this into one single record, so that we are able to create one common, one single record. So the aggregation pattern I will normally use when we have to build a single view of our customers, and I want to do it in my CRM instance, and customers, for example, self-register on a public website, they enter their username, first name, last name, email address in a form of self-registration, but then we have also a system for managing some other services. I remember an experience with a public council, and they have a system for offering services for registration to a public library, for example, or to access to some venues for some events in the community. And unfortunately, all these systems have a different database. So it means that Stefano Tempesta in the library system had an account, and Stefano Tempesta, same person in the community event system, had another account. The challenge is that as a council, I want to see what Stefano Tempesta is doing in my entire community, in the council itself, so that I can do some promotion or some discounts or maybe even pay some taxes, right? So this was consolidated into Dynamics 365, into the CRM component of it. And the challenge was obviously avoid duplication of records, identifying natural keys. Last name, first name, last name is not enough. Maybe mail address, maybe phone number, maybe social security number, or driving license number. There are different conditions. Some information is missing in one system, some information is available in the other one. So there are challenges there of merging. And this is the aggregation pattern in some way. What else? The bidirectional sync pattern. This is now, we are extending our Dynamics 365 to another line of business application that provides some specialized service. I'm thinking of SharePoint now. I'm thinking of a document repository where we really don't want to store large documents in Dynamics 365. It's not meant for it, right? We want to use a dedicated application that does the job well. Not only for storage, because at the end of storage, I can even use a shared drive, but for workflow processing on documents. So if I'm attaching a document to a case in my Dynamics 365 case instance, and then I want to do some processing on this document, for example, turn a document into a record when the case is closed, or do some versioning, or attach a process of reviewing documents and approval. This is something that I would normally do in an enterprise content management solution like SharePoint. But still I want to create a connection between the two. So from SharePoint, when I open the document, I see that this is attached to a specific case in my Unified Service Desk application in the 365. And vice versa, when I'm opening a case in USD in 365, I want to access this document in real time. So the two systems have to talk to each other. And last one that I have in the list of common integration patterns is the correlation pattern. So now this is very similar to what we have seen before in terms of Dynamics 365 talking to another system, a web portal, an ERP, for example. But instead of doing as we have seen before with the broadcast pattern, so when so a record in D365 is visible, also is a pro is published also to the other system, this identifies a subset of all the records that is an intersection. So it means that the record has to exist, it must exist in all the systems in order to be available, in this case, as you see on the screen, in my CRM solution, web portal, ERP. Typical application that I have had the opportunity to play with in some way, to implement, is health records in health institutes, in a hospital or clinics, where you don't want just to make a health record for a patient available to any other clinic, unless that is a patient of all the clinics, of all the hospitals. So I'm able to share my record, information about my patient, only if this patient is available in all the systems that are requesting this information. So I'm not broadcasting, I'm not aggregating, I'm intersecting, I'm correlating this information with other systems that already have the record itself. So there is a change of address in this patient, I will log into my CRM, but also correlate with hospital A, hospital B, clinic C, because they already have this information. There are the usual challenges of matching this this record, as we have seen also for the aggregation pattern, but probably they are mitigated, because if a record already exists, it means that an initial matching has been done, and now we have a kind of map between the primary keys in each system, and then we can easily correlate each other and update the record specifically in the system that are connected, where the record matches. Okay, so this was an overall just excursion across different integration patterns that can be implemented in different systems. This is obviously not specific to Dynamics 365 solely, but it's a good way to understand what are the typical challenges of integration and how systems like ESB can help mitigate them. But before we jump into that, let me take a little step back. So first of all, I want to look into Enterprise Service Bus, and I will specifically talk about the publish-subscribe pattern, and we will see also how this is implemented in Service Bus in Azure. There are other systems. Service Bus in Azure is one of the platforms that I had the pleasure to play with, and I will show you how easy it is to configure Service Bus in Azure and consume services from a .NET application. So I will shortly jump off the slide and make a live demo with some little C# code of it. But I want to take a little step back, if you don't mind, just to reiterate on the challenge of point-to-point integrations. Point-to-point integrations are great when I need real-time information between these two systems, but there are challenges. Challenges where, you know, we have tangle integration between our CRM and my web or my mobile apps, or between the data warehouse and the web and exposing some APIs to the public, or my ERP talking to the CRM, to the payroll system, to the HR system, and then sending an email or an SMS and so on. So you start getting the idea, right? So this will get more and more tangled. Each point, each line of connection requires, first of all, an agreement on the data format. What is the source and what is the target data format? If my ERP system is talking to my CRM, they need to agree on the format of the message. And this is typically done by mapping record F name match to first name, record L name match, sorry, no record, column, last L name matches to last name. So there must be some format. It's not only a simple matching, but there may be some format conversion. What is stored in one entity as a date time may be two different fields, one for the date, one for the time. Or if it is a numeric field in a system, maybe a text format in another system, and it will need some conversion, and so on. These are typical challenges of mapping different attributes in entities across different systems. But that's not the only situation. How about the availability of each endpoint in this connection? What if the source system is not available? Fine. In that case, if there is a scheduled integration, the integration would not be triggered, and the integration itself or the data transfer would not happen. So fair enough. But what happens if the target destination doesn't respond because it's busy, because it's in maintenance, because is something changed on the access to it? My ERP system is sending a package, sending a message to my CRM. The CRM doesn't respond. What happened to the parcel? Is it lost? Is it in the post office? What is this post office? It is a queue of messages. Someone has to implement it. And third, I mentioned about security. All these line of communication require the channel itself to be secure and each endpoint to be authenticated. And fourth, what happens if I want to replace one of these systems? I will need to agree again on the format, implement a new security protocol, and change all the line of communication of this one system across this landscape. What I mean, say that we want to change the CRM. Okay, no, we don't change the CRM. Dynamics 365, we love it, we don't change it. But maybe we want to change our email system. Sending an email is typically invoking an API. And this is done in my CRM, in my ERP, in my web application, even in my data warehouse for some reason. All of them talk to the email provider, to my SMTP server directly. And they all have implemented the specific call to this API. I change my email provider. I have to go into all these 4, 5, 6, 10 applications and change the way they talk to my email server. Obviously, this is a big challenge. Now, how this can be resolved? A typical approach is to use an enterprise service bus. So an enterprise service bus, an ESB, sits as a middleman in between all these applications and make this tangled integration landscape a bit tighter. It's tighter because, first of all, each application has to talk to the ESB and not directly to another application. That's resolving merely the challenge number four that I mentioned before. If I were to replace my SMS gateway or my email server, I will only have to replace that one line of connection because all the other systems will still publish the message to the ESB. And then the ESB will take care of dispatching this message to the mail server. So if I change the mail server, again, I will only have to change the communication between the ESB and the mail server without touching the other applications at all. It also provides a queuing mechanism. All the messages are published into the ESB and dispatched to the other applications. If the target application is not available, the message will stay in the queue. It will still have a life cycle, so I can define how long the message stays in the queue until it's processed, and if after 10 retries or 10 days, the message will be killed, but at least I have a form of guarantee of delivery. Additional benefit that I get is that I can also build some form of workflows, which is basically a way to start creating several steps in at each phase of integration of communication, so that I can add some transformation of the message itself. I would classify this as a purely ETL process, so as in extracting, transforming, and loading data. There are different tools for that, but application like that I have used, like BizTalk or like Scribe, for example, they do provide this kind of workflow. You can submit this information in input, then do some form of manipulation, or you can massage the data, as we like to say, and then provide this in output. It's a workflow that you apply as part of the transformation itself. And last but not the least, the security part of it. So that funny triangle that you see under the data warehouse box is actually a funnel. It didn't come out very well, but it's a funnel. What I mean is that the data warehouse has subscribed to receive some information only and not all the messages that are in the ESB. That is the publish subscribe pattern. From the CRM, for example, I'm publishing some information, so I'm sending this to the ESB, and this is available in the queue, but under a specific topic. A data warehouse registered to receive information from a topic only, and they are authorized to get this information only if the message is labeled with this specific topic. This is a way to guarantee protection of sensitive data, for example, so that the CRM can send a different information. They are all in the queue of the ESB, but not all the applications can actually access them. Access all these pieces of information. All right, okay, so let me jump into Azure Service Bus to make an example of it. Just briefly, how that works. Azure Service Bus provide messaging queuing, which is basically a guarantee of delivery. The message is in the queue and can be delivered as soon as an application retrieve it from the queue. If not, it will stay in the queue until the end of its defined life cycle. It also provides topics, which is exactly what has been described before, this publish subscribe mechanism. An application, our dynamic CRM server, publish this message in a specific topic, and only third-party applications that are able to access this topic can read this information. Service Bus also provides a few other things like a relay and an event hub. We won't have the time to go through all of them today, but very briefly, a relay is used for real-time communication. As you understand, a service bus is not real-time simply because there is a queue. So the message goes into the queue and then an application will read from the queue. That kills the real-time communication. By using relay in Azure Service Bus, I can still implement real-time communication. And an event hub is basically a response to some specific events that trigger actions, typically used in the context of IoT devices, the Internet of Things. As a device, I'm streaming some live data to my service bus, or I'm measuring the temperature or the UV exposure, and this information trigger some actions if some conditions are met. So, for example, if the temperature exceed 40 degrees Celsius, then it's too hot and I will send an alert or something. Now, so this is how the Event Hub works basically. All right, so enough for the slides for now. Let me get into my Azure portal and show you how to create a service bus and how to configure a queue and a topic so that we can consume some information from the service bus directly. Right, hopefully you can see my Azure portal here. Actually, let me zoom in a bit so it's slightly better visible to everybody. I already have a service bus created, but if you were to create a new one, simply search for service bus and will come out of the list. It takes a few minutes to create a new instance of the service bus, so I'm not going to do it now in the interest of time. There is already one that I have pre-created. Now, once you open your service bus instance in Azure, and again, it takes just a few minutes to create, you need a couple of pieces of information in order to be able to access it. One is your connection string, which is basically a URL, or it's not just a URL, it's more than that. It's a connection string, so it's made of different pieces of information to access that is attached to a specific policy. And the policy defines the actions that this that I can do, which is basically manage the entire service bus or only send information or only listen. So you will typically allow only send to applications that want to submit information and only listen to applications that want to listen. If your application in the connection that we have seen before should be able to send and listen, so to publish and subscribe, it will probably tick both boxes. But that's all you need. You need a primary key, you need a connection string to enable your connectivity from an application into your service bus. So let me get back now to the service bus. And then after that, you actually need to define a queue and a topic. Let's go in order. Let's define a queue. So you will see here under entities, you have a queues. And a queue is nothing less than just a name. So let's create a queue. Give it a name. I'm going to call it ratings queue. And I will show you in a moment why. You want to define the size of this queue. So in gigabytes, how big is this queue? You can go from 1 to 5. And the lifetime of the message. After 14 days, you can this message is removed from the queue if no one, if no other application access this message. And there are other parameters that just enable the life cycle of the messages in the queue. Let's create this queue. This should take really a few seconds. Done. So we have a queue. And if you open the queue, we have a nice dashboard with some information. Obviously, there are 0 messages and in the queue. So 100% of space in the queue is free to be used at the moment. Now, how do we consume this queue from a third-party application? All right, let me zoom out a bit and go into my Visual Studio solution. What I have here is a very simple web application. Let me open it so you can see also on screen for entering ratings for any product. Okay, so it's opening now in a second. Is a ASP.NET application, and this is my is my web portal. Okay, so I'm adding a new rating. Now, this is pretend is a web application. Don't look at the UI of it. I'm not a web designer. I'm trying to keep it super simple. So I would say that this webcast and then the rating. 3, and then I'll create this. And this has sent a message to the queue. How that works? Okay, let me keep this for a moment, and I'll show you a bit of the code, how that works. I want to zoom in. Here we go. So we have, this is an MVC application. I'm sending this message in post, as an HTTP post. and I'm creating a new rating. The rating, as we see, has an item name and a value for it. So that's all I need to do. I need to create a QClient from my connection string, serialize my rating model in JSON, and wrap with a broker message that I send to the queue asynchronously. Three lines of code. Create a QClient from a connection string. And the connection string is something that I have defined in my web config, right? So in my web config, I have my service bus connection string that I copied from the Azure portal. Then I serialize in JSON my model and then wrap with a broker message. So what is QClient and what is broker message? Hopefully you can see, but they are basically part of the Microsoft.ServiceBus.Messaging namespace, which is a package that you can reference in your solution as a NuGet package. And is all you need to do is down here is your Windows Azure.ServiceBus. That's all you need in order to have access to a very nice .NET wrapper, .NET library that allows to communicate with the Azure Service Bus in really three lines of code. One to define a connection to the queue, another one to wrap your message as a broker message, and then to send asynchronously. Now, all communication to the bus are asynchronous. You mean this is a typical fire and forget situation where you send a message and it goes to the bus and the bus will take care of it. Now, how do we read this message? Okay, first of all, let's have a look where the message is. So if I go back to my dashboard in Azure, at some point, let me close and open again my queue. I should see the message somewhere. Here we go. As you can see, that's my one message and is active. Now, the space is 100% free because we have allocated 1 GB of space and my message will consume really a few bytes. Now, if you remember, I just typed webcast value number 3. So if you count the bytes, we've probably been 10 or less. I mean, we have also serialized as a JSON, so probably will be a bit more. But irrespective of that, it really doesn't have a big impact on the free space. It will be 99.9999% free. Anyway, so the important thing is that we have one message in the queue. How do we read it? So we can read it in any other application. And the way we do that, I have another console app that reads from the queue. And what this app is doing is reading from the service bus queue. And as you can see here, it's exactly the same as we have seen before, but in reverse order. So we still need a queue client from the connection string. That is exactly the same connection string that I have defined in my app config. So service bus connection string, exactly the same. The difference is now that once I have the client, the client does a kind of listening to a message. As soon as the message is available in the queue, it will trigger this event, the on message event. And now I need to deserialize the object into a rating class from the body of the message. So again, two lines of code, really. And when the message is available, get the body of the message, deserialize, and obtain a rating. And then display the rating on screen. So if I now execute this application, it will just open a connection to the queue and a display waiting webcast equals 3. Okay, so let me zoom in a bit. Oh, sorry, I lost it. Okay, there was a webcast equals 3 on screen. So that means that my website has sent this message to the queue, has been there in the queue for some time until I have executed this console app, which is a completely separate application, which has retrieved this message from the queue. And this is how you will do it in any other conditions between your Dynamics 365 solution or any other application as well. And I will show you how to do this in D365 in a moment, building a plugin for that. But before we show you how to do the plugin, let's carry on with the second part of the queuing of messages in Azure Service Bus, which is actually the topic. Because now what happened is that as a website, I publish my rating in the queue, and the console app could read this message from the queue. But actually, there was no protection. Any application could read it. Any application with access to the service bus, obviously. I want now to restrict access only to applications that subscribe to a specific topic. Okay, so I do that. First of all, let me go back to my Azure Service Bus. I don't need the queue any longer. I need now a topic. So a topic, again, I need a name. So I'll create a name and I'll call it ratings topic. Usual size, lifetime, create. It takes a few seconds and we have a topic. Now, this looks very similar to the queue, and indeed, if I open it, I have the same dashboard with the free space, the number of messages in the topic. So what's the difference? Now, the difference is in here. I need to define a subscription. So I need to define which application is able to read information from this topic, and only applications that have this label, this subscription, can read from this topic. So app subscription is again a name. Let me call it console app because I will do it from the console app. But this is where you define the name of your application. This can be your Dynamics 365, your ERP, your mobile app. So this is basically a way to restrict access by giving a name to this subscription and then using this name from your application. A bit of config on the lifecycle again and create lifecycle of the message and create. And here it is. We have a console app subscription available for this specific topic. So let's go to my Visual Studio solution again in my web application. So now I don't want to use my queue client. I need to use a topic client. That's it. That's all I have to do. Obviously, instead of the queue name, there would be the topic name. So the topic name, it was down here, here we go, is, no, sorry, this is not necessary, is topic name is ratings topic, okay? And my client is a topic client. All done. I still want to serialize my model, my rating, I wrap into a broker message and I send it to my topic client asynchronously. So that's all I have to do from a client application that is publishing a message into the service bus. Just change from queue topic to topic client. And that's all I need. So let me build this application and open in the browser, view in the browser. I will add the new ratings and I say this webcast is getting better and better, so now is 4, create. Okay, what happened now is this message, this rating model in the combination of item and value has been sent to the topic. Now, my console app, so let me go now to my console app, should be able to read from the topic, but not only from a specific topic, but a topic with a specific subscription. So when I create my client, now instead of using a topic client, I need to use a subscription client. So this is different from the queuing. If you remember before, we have used the queue client for both publishing and reading information from the bus. When using topic, the application that is publishing the information will use a topic client, but the application that is reading this information from the topic will use a subscription client. And a subscription client requires three parameters: the connection string as usual, the topic name, which is ratings topic, as you can see here, but also the subscription name, which is console app, as we have defined in my topic. And only applications that have this subscription name are able to read the message from the topic. After that, everything is the same. We register an event handler for the on message event. When the message is available, so when this event is triggered, we read the body of the message itself, deserialize from JSON into a rating object, and then display on screen. So if all is good, my ratings, which I need to open again, should be in the topic here. And it's here. You see that is under is one message count in console app. Okay. And if I now run this application, it should come out on screen. Waiting, and hopefully it will come out in some time. It's not super fast, but it should come out. And I'm doing something wrong, because if we look into the solution here, I'm reading from the queue. Instead, I need to change this to read from the topic. Okay, that was my mistake. Here we go. So read from the topic. Open again. Waiting. Hopefully, here we go. Webcast equals 4. Okay, it's gone on the screen. But that's it. So message gone again through the specific subscription from the website and to the console app. All right, so we have a few more minutes, and before opening for a few questions at the end, I want to go through a recent implementation of data integration in D365 using Power Apps. This is a relatively new model, and it is work in progress in some way. The CDS, the Common Data Services, and the CDM, the Common Data Model, something that Microsoft has introduced in the recent month as part of the process of unifying all the different Dynamics applications under one single common model. So now we are not referring any longer to CRM, AX, and the other application separately, but we are looking into a data model for all our entities that are in common across the different applications. And this is a way to address the aggregator challenge, basically, where our ERP system, maybe our AX solution, is talking to the CRM, and the common data model represents a way to identify a single entity for the same account, for example. CDS, the common data services, is the process, or is the service, for offering this, the CDM, the model, across the different applications that are part of the Dynamics 365 family. And for applications that are not part of the 365 family, so third-party applications, we have a data integrator, which is a service for connecting environments or databases and let them talk to each other using the CDM, the Common Data Model. All right, so in the few minutes remaining, let me show you how that works in real life. So we have our Power Apps portal. On the left-hand side, you will see here there is a tab called Common Data Services, and you will have entities and pick list. So entities is a list of all our entities defined in the CDM. As a common data model. And you will see we have account, alumnus, business unit, case, competitor, contact, and so on. So if I open, for example, the account entity, we have a list of all the fields, the type of the fields. It's basically a description of the entity itself here in the browser. And this is a common account entity. If I want to import or export data, I can use the functionality here, import and export, that you see in the ribbon. Or for legacy or traditional system, I can export a template in an Excel format, let the third-party application fill in this Excel spreadsheet, and then import again from Excel. It's a bit of a manual process, obviously, because it will require someone to upload the file actually, but the template that we can that we generate by exporting the account entity reflect the exact definition of all the fields with also validation on the format as defined on screen, and I can obviously add other fields or change that. I mean, I cannot change the required one, but I can modify some of the fields in here. I can define keys. There is only a primary key in this case, but I can add additional keys also for this entity and relationship itself. So this account also relates to a contact, or to an account group, or to a business unit, to an organization, and so on. So it will create a relationship between a field in the entity and another entity. There are also pick list or lookup values, which basically provide a kind of drop-down list with values that we want to display for specific fields in an entity. For example, an account status. The account is active or inactive. Or, I don't know, let me see, there are so many. Can be a contact type. So is a contact through email, Facebook, phone, Twitter, and so on. And there are different other approval status. So if an object, an item has been approved, is confirmed, is in draft, rejected, and so on. So these are typical lookup values, or also known as pick list, that are defined as part of my common data service. Now, how do I connect, how do I consume this data service or this data model from other applications? I do it through a connection. I need to establish a connection. If you see on the screen here, I have a connection to my Dynamics 365 portal, to my mail provider, to my SharePoint site, and so on. I can create many connections, and there is a very large library of connections that are already predefined by Power Apps, and more Microsoft is adding on a regular basis. I can also build my own custom connector with a proper SDK. So say that I want to connect to the Adobe Creative Cloud or to Amazon Redshift for Data Warehouse, or to Box, or to Dropbox. So there are a lot of connections that I can establish. And if I pick one, then I will need to authenticate into this system, and I will need to provide my username and password for authenticating into Dropbox in this case. I really don't have a Dropbox account, so I can't really do it that now. And so on. There are many connections that are available. As you can see, it is a very long list which means that you don't have to care too much how to extract information out of this. It will be done as part of the connection, the common data service. And one last thing that I want to show you is the data integrator, which is available in the admin center. So for some reason it's not here on this front page of Power Apps. You have to go into the admin center. So you do need admin privileges on Power Apps. And here is where you define your different environment, which is basically your kind of database, your repository of all your entities. And then you define the data integration process. There are different templates that you can use, for example, sales to CDS or sales to financial, financial to operation, sales orders. So there are already data that put together the different application under 365. So sales, talking to financial, talking to operations, they are all under the same integration project. You don't need to reinvent this mapping every time. You don't need to write this mapping every time. It's already done. There is a template. You just have to use the one that you need. If the integration requirement is not in the list of the system template, and then you will need to create a connection set. And with a connection set, then define your own integration between an initial environment and a target environment. So you can see, choose a connection. It's coming up. It takes probably some time to refresh the list, but this is the source connection where you define what is in your source environment to connect to, and then to which environment you are going. And in my case, it's going to the LangTech environment, which is the only environment that I defined. I can also propagate this to additional connections, or I can add another connection. I don't know why it's not coming out. It's taking some time. Maybe it's my connection. But anyway, here is how you define multiple connections, and then you do the mapping, which is that this field is connected to this other field, and once you save this connection set, then it will come up as a new project based on a specific connection set, and it will stay there as a template that you can use over and over again. Right, so we are really nearly on top of the hours. We have finished with the time. Unfortunately, I would love to talk about these Power Apps for longer. But thanks for listening. Hope you found some ideas, something interesting to practice in the future with your integration requirements. My social coordinates are on screen again. Feel free to get in touch for any additional clarification. This webcast has been recorded, and there's also going to be an article attached to it that Jason has promised to publish very soon. And Jason, back to you. If there are any last-minute questions, I'm happy to take them now.
Thanks, Tim. Thanks, Stefano. So let's look here for the questions that have come in so far. We are going to share the recording. I'm not sure yet on actually sharing the PowerPoint slides. We will definitely keep everyone in the audience updated on that. There's a question that came in earlier, I think even before the EBS, ESB stuff, yep. Asking about suggested approaches for mapping, for mappings, and if there are any that you recommend, like for mapping, like a text field in one system to you know, a pick list in a target system was one example that was raised.
Yes, okay. We briefly seen this when looking into the Power Apps in the Common Data Model. So you have the possibility, you know, if I just switch here to Power Apps, I need to define your entities and exporting this account, for example, with as a template, and then you will do the mapping in there. With the data integrator, you actually do the mapping directly on screen, and that is inside Power Apps. So that is the approach if you were using Power Apps. If you do this programmatically, so forget Power Apps, but you are C# the developer, you're using Enterprise Service Bus, then you need to do your data mapping in code. It's not ideal, but you have full control on it. Third option, use application like Scribe, for example, that I also use a lot, where you do the data mapping completely visual on screen. You have your source on the left, your target on the right, and then visually you do mapping between one system and the other one. One entity and the other one.
Okay, interesting. And I know we're at the top of the hour here. Are you able to take a few more questions?
Let's take a couple more questions, sure.
All right, great. So someone asked, in the case of the service bus, it didn't appear that there was any authentication requested during the development. Is it secure?
There is authentication. Probably I went very quickly on top of it, but basically in your Azure portal, here you have this shared access, not here, but at service bus level, you have this policy. The policy has a connection string, and this connection string you just have to put into your web config, here it is, and then use it when creating a connection from the connection string itself. This is all you need in terms of authentication. And permissions are set at policy level, where you define whether you have a full control, which is manage, or only send, or only listen to messages in the queue.
Do we have any benchmark tests regarding the speed of the solution, specifically the Power Apps approach?
Yeah, good question. The short answer is I don't, to be honest. And Service Bus takes some time. It's not meant for real-time application. Power Apps, they can do real-time, yes, because it's actually not a Service Bus. Power Apps is a data mapping and a data integration tool. So if you are after speed, yes, Power Apps. If you are after all the benefits that we have described in the ESB, the message queuing, the workflow, then yes, you will not get real time, but you get the queuing mechanism and so on.
Any thoughts on the impact of virtual entities?
Not supported at the moment in Power Apps. Hopefully we'll get soon. If you're doing this with a traditional approach with the SDK, no problem at all. Unfortunately, I didn't have time to show you in Visual Studio, but if we were to write CRM plugins, the access to the queue in the plugin is exactly the same. Here on screen, you have a topic client, you connect to your service bus, serialize your object and send asynchronously. Because this is a CRM plugin, the plugin context, so you're using the CRM SDK or XRM SDK, so you have access to all the entities. So if you are playing with virtual entities, you can do it through the SDK by coding at the moment. I'm not aware of any way of doing Power Apps.
Do multiple subscribers to a topic use the... I'm probably going to mangle this question a bit, but does multiple subscribes to a topic using the same subscriber key? If there are multiple subscribers using the same subscriber key, they both receive the message.
Ah, yes, actually, yes, good point. Yes, they do. They do. And the life cycle of the message is controlled by a parameter that you have to specify. Now, I don't remember off the top of my head. I will need to look into the documentation. But you can define when you react to this message, if you want to take the message out of the topic immediately or only at the end of the life cycle itself. So if you take out of the immediately, it actually works like a queue. First in, first served, a message is gone. Otherwise, the default behavior is it stays there until the last application takes over. How do you know it is the last application? You can do it programmatically or is part of the configuration settings. But yeah, good point. I forgot to mention that's the difference. The queue is one message and the first one will take it. The topic stays until the last application has consumed it.
Okay, I see two more questions here at the moment. Mm-hmm. For an integration between CRM Online and CRM On-Prem, do you use Power Apps or API Manager?
Power Apps can do it, yes. I can do it in Power Apps as well, because if I go in here and I search a new connection, I will be able to connect. There is something on my internet connection that's not working, but I will be able to connect to my Dynamics installation. So not only 365, but also my CRM on-prem, and I can do it in two ways. One, it is available online, so fair enough. But if it is on-prem, so it is actually secured, I don't have public or internet access, I will need to specify an agent to work as a proxy. But yes, I can do that as well, and it works also for SharePoint, I believe. When I do SharePoint, yes, you see SharePoint is asking me if it is a SharePoint cloud service or using a data gateway for on-premises installation. In that case, Windows authentication, username and password, take the gateway and connect. I don't have an example to show now. It will take some time to configure it, but that's the approach to take normally, yes.
Okay, and last question I'm seeing here is asking for the correct scenario for integrating with intranet services.
Right, okay. Well, if the internet service is like SharePoint, as we said now, then yes, I will need an agent to do a bridge or a gateway and open the connection to SharePoint without exposing SharePoint. Any other systems, then I will need to build a custom connector, very likely, because it is your own application. I don't know what it is. I will need to communicate in a custom way. And we can build custom connectors in Power Apps as well. There is an SDK, you need to implement some interfaces, and then it will publish into the list of connections. Or otherwise, if it is done through the ESB in code, then ESB supports different protocols, not only HTTP or HTTPS. You can use also different other protocols. Obviously, you will need to open the pertinent port on your firewall to enable the communication. But yes, you are able to connect your, say, legacy or traditional application in your intranet all over some other protocols that are not only HTTP if the application is not online.
All right. Well, thanks to everyone in the audience for so many good questions. And Stefano, I think we are through all of them. So let me just say thank you also to you for taking the time to put together this excellent presentation and take so many audience questions.
Thanks again, everybody. Have a good rest of the day.
Yeah, and that concludes today's event. We will be reaching out with an update when the recording is available. Bye.